prepared a presentation for people who will not start, but who, let's say, know less about gender. And now I see so high-level professionals. At the end, they will say, we lost our time going to Perugia. Of course, it's nice to go to Perugia, to see Perugia and so on. But what we learn from this training, so what we talked today with Silvia, and I am so happy that she supported me, we discussed that all this pilot training, as she also said, it is a process of translation. We have this perfect output done by many people, this standard. It is excellent paper, but theoretical to some extent. So the big issue is how to translate it to everyday work people will do. And you, as experts, are here not to, to learn from my presentation, but to think how things which I will present today will help you to start thinking what kind of trainings you will offer to our final beneficiaries. People who are doing this type of counseling, you know, these transition processes, who are counseling students at school, schools, teachers, people in public employment service. We don't want them to be gender experts, and nobody wants them to be there. How is my book now? Good. Because we start smiling and maybe I don't. So, these people, you know very well that all this theory, gender theory, is something which is developing every day. What we believed about gender 20 years ago, you are much younger than I am, so probably you don't remember what was 20 years ago, but what we believed 20 years ago is a little bit different now. So this theory is developing, our ideas are also developing. We'll know today more about women and men than we know 20 years ago. But people who are doing their job counseling this, other people in this transition process, they don't need to be gender experts. So our role is what kind of awareness we have to offer them, what kind of sensitivity we have to offer them, because if they are not enough aware and enough sensitized, and they think, well, we are neutral towards women and men, we are doing, our job for people, we don't care who is there, boy or girl, I will counseling students, not boys and girls. Sometimes this gender neutral approach may produce more harm than people even have idea about. So you will see today some visual materials, some theoretical definitions, visual material, sometimes very funny, sometimes a little bit naive. But if we think about our beneficiaries, let's think also about people whom they will consult. Those people will come from different backgrounds, from different cultures, with different understanding about gender. Maybe they even don't think about gender and never consider it in their everyday life. But somehow, if we don't translate our knowledge, our experience, our theoretical approach to that people, the counselor and the client, you know, it will be again only theory. So please think in a practical terms and be critical what kind of definitions we need. We have to start now. You will see that in my presentation I use the thesaurus, which is produced by the European Institute of Gender Equality. Sylvia?
Yeah.
Shall I just
click yes, here? Yes.
Okay. So this is a huge work done by European experts, gender experts. As you know, European Institute of Gender Equality, it is a little bit heavy, maybe it will need some time. European Institute of Gender Equality is a specialized agency of the European Union on gender issues, and it is a huge project. As you see, you can find a lot of terms here. I highly recommend you to use it because let's open one of the. I want to go to gender.
Right side.
Ah, yes, Sylvia, thank you. You're so smart and so friendly.
No, I had enough time to look at it.
So, what is interesting with this glossary or thesaurus or whatever you name it? Very interesting is that those with definitions, this is a huge group of experts who work on it to decide what to put as a definition. Because definition of gender also has developed during the years in its time being. So, source of the definitions might be either UN agency responsible for gender equality or European Commission from some of its documents, or World Health Organization. It depends which definition suits the term which they put in the glossary. Now, European Institute of Gender Equality is working on the translation of this glossary into the languages of the European Union member states. It is a huge project. Probably they will do it in some stages. I don't know, at least I know, because I'm coming from Bulgaria, I know that they are working on the translation of it into Bulgarian language. So probably they will start as Julia today when she ask us to stay in a circle from A, B, C, and no further. I don't know. But I very much recommend you, when you have time, look at it. You will find very interesting definitions which will help your work. And it is also a standard. That's what's important. We are using, now we can go there, look at the definition, and we can use it as a common understanding among all of us. What is interesting also, for some terms, they just put a blank page asking, please, give us your suggestion, which is also interesting because people can really actively, gender experts from different countries can offer them their own vision about some terms. So, let me leave this nice tool. Gender analysis, gender and development, gender audit, gender awareness, you have everything here. So, to start with the very basic things. Let's start with sex and gender. Even it is a little bit boring, and as I said, I will not offer you nothing, absolutely nothing what you don't know until now. I'm sorry, probably I use very strange language. Sex versus gender, productive and reproductive work. As I said, I put sometimes strange images just to talk about these issues from very serious point of view. You know, sometimes we need some visual material to be more understandable. Why I'm stressing on this? Because this biological and biological, psychological and sociological differences, very often people don't understand them well, and even now there are a lot of discussions here and there, what is gender about, what is sex about, and so on. So gender refers to these biological and psychological characteristics. I'm reading the definition from the glossary which I already mentioned. They define humans as female or male. This is the definition of the World Health Organization. So gender-based assumptions and expectations generally place women at a disadvantage position with respect to the sustainable enjoyment of rights, such as freedom to act and to be recognized as autonomous, and so on and so on. This is the definition of the UN Women, and their concept and definitions about sex and gender. So, as you know, there are conservative or traditionalist people who stress too much on this biological side of our identity and neglecting this social role which gender has in our lives. So about female and male work, about their reproductive and productive aspects. So usually reproductive work is a childbearing and it is associated with supporting and servicing the current and future workforce. Those who undertake or will in the undertake productive work. However, there are many experts who put more stress on the social reproduction as part of reproductive work, to indicate that this reproductive work has a broader scope than simply to be associated with biological reproduction. And reproductive work is usually related to women, are associated with women, as well as this community managing work which comprises activities undertaken by women primarily at the community level. It is free of charge, it is paid work, it is undertaken in their free time, like participation in parents, teachers, associations at schools, or work with church, or work on some other community activities, things like this. Usually, or a group of moms who are childbearing together. There are a lot of activities which they work and do without any payment, which is considered, what is important, part of their reproductive role. This is part of their reproductive role. While productive work, of course, is more somehow related to men, not only because women also work paid work outside home, and their numbers are growing there. But community politics, let's say, or community management, or community work of men is usually paid, it is usually formal, it is usually connected with status and power. And because all of us have our own understanding about gender, about gender identity, about femininity, masculinity, and we also perceive our own gender identity sometimes in different kinds, depending on the situation we are in. I think that there are a lot of myths and facts about it. And when we are preparing our training for people, the final beneficiaries of our project, we need to have them in mind, because it is better to offer them something that is somehow connection, is in connection with their understanding, in order to see whether their understanding is changing and how it is changing. Not to give too much theoretical approach or definitions or information, because people who are not experts, sometimes they are lost in it. So, what AGE gives us as a definition of gender. Gender refers to the social attributes and opportunities associated with being female or male, and also the relationships between women and men and girls and boys, as well as the relations between women and those between men. I will come into this later to give you some examples, because it is also interesting, especially for children, for boys and girls, how they create this idea about gender identity, and how they also think about other boys or girls about other girls in their own group. So, as you know, gender, all these attributes, opportunities, relationships are context and time specific and changeable, which is the best, let's say, part of the thing. Because what is important now, or what is, how to say, perceived as very traditional or very tough to explain, it can be changed with our work. So gender is usually part of the broader socio-cultural context. In most societies, there are differences and inequalities between women and men in responsibilities assigned, activities undertaken, access and control of resources, as well as decision-making opportunities. And because we are talking in our project about women and men, we are not going into discussion what are the other parts of our personal identities, as our sexuality, for example, and things like this. We are talking only for women, about women and men. Which is important is to avoid any kind of gender bias. And this is the definition which AGE is offering about gender bias. On actions and thoughts based on the gender-based perception conception that women are not equal to men in rights and dignity. And also, another part of our gender identity, not another part, but our gender identity refers how we feel about ourselves, about our individual experience, how we experience gender, our own gender, and how we express it. Because each of us has many different roles, and maybe more than this nice, maybe blonde lady on the left, who is a cyclist, cat person, sister, daughter, friend, and so many other roles. How she thinks and express her own gender is the most important part of her gender identity. So, gender, as you know, all these attributes, opportunities, relationships are socially constructed, are through socialization process. And gender determines what is expected, allowed, and valued in a woman or a man in a given context. And you know, here are two very common, let's say, pictures, but I will show you one very interesting video. Societies quickly accept that myth that girls are vulnerable and boys are strong and independent. From Baltimore to Shanghai and Nairobi and New Delhi, they found the same behavior. Because, you know, when we talk about socialization process, and many of you are teachers and you know, you have ideas, ideology, which is translated into practice, into behavior. So it is interesting how these children, because the group is of children from 11 to 13 years of age, how they translate what they see around them in the same result in different parts of the world, in Nairobi and in Baltimore, they did at the end the same thing. It is very interesting, for example, how boys, I want to give you one example which is very interesting, how boys challenging norms. For example, in Baltimore, those who do not play sports, do households, cook, wash, have girls' hair, they are not acceptable. In New Delhi, those boys are speaking about other boys. Boys who are looking after parents are not acceptable. Not arguing with parents are not acceptable. It is not male behavior. Helping mother in household chores, like cooking, as well as being shy, it is not acceptable. In Ghent, Belgium, those who do not like football, who need or jump ropes, love Barbie dolls, and love pink, are not acceptable. Shanghai, China, again, boys about boys. Those who wear womanish clothes and accessories, being soft, shy, undecisive, speaking a weak voice, talk and walk like a girl, crying a lot and could not fight. So you see, it's quite interesting that, and this is one part of the conclusions of this research, that when children felt that crying, for example, is not acceptable in group of the boys, they immediately stop doing this because they want to be accepted as male, of course. So this is making all these prejudices even more stronger and more difficult for themselves, how to deal with this. Of course, all these things later is reflecting in their choices in life. So there are three very important processes we have to be aware about when we are thinking about our final beneficiaries and their plans, and especially final beneficiaries, people who will advise, who give advice in career or in some other issues. If they don't take into account gender-based differences when looking at any social phenomenon, policy or process, they have to develop these skills, these feelings about long-term or about immediate needs and long-term interests of women and men. So these people we expect to be more gender sensitized if they take into account all these differences. If they don't take into account different roles and diverse needs of women and men and maintain the status quo and do not transform the unequal structure of gender relations, then we name them as gender blind, because they don't see these differences. And if they refer to concept, laws, policies, or style of language, which is not associated with either women or men, we call them of these policies or this approach gender neutral. And what is often perceived to be gender neutral often reflects gender blindness in practice. A failure to recognize gender specificities. And then, of course, you cannot be efficient in your advice. If you are gender blind or if you are gender neutral.